to Carrara Rangeland Park. Something completely different. Should be a total outback, total isolation. Hoping to see no one. Weather's looking pretty epic for us this week, so we're really looking forward to camping out here, actually. Looking like a real outback experience. But pretty much this week what we're doing is we're doing a little bit of the Golden Trail in the Midwest, which follows the history of the gold mining industry in the West. And when we get bored of that, we'll head to the coast, do some fishing, do some swimming, do some relaxing.
Find a gold nugget, hopefully.
Well, you can only.
Maybe even a gold band snapper then.
Huh? That's all, folks. We'll see you later. What a cracker of a morning. First day on our trip, and we've got to Carrara Rangeland, which is a very remote campsite, probably 50-60 k's from Paynes Find. But yeah, we found this gem last night, and it's a total beauty. There's just no one here, and it's total isolation. And yeah, we're walking up to this morning. Beautiful evening, hardly any wind, nothing but birds chirping during the night. Beautiful campsite, plenty of wood, and what more can you ask for?
After spending the night camped at Munga Lake, we decide to explore the island at the centre of the salt pan in the early hours of the morning to avoid the 30 degree expected heat forecast, considering it was a 7 kilometre return walk.
Finally made it. We're walking for about an hour, I reckon. And we're now at this island. Island of rock in the middle of a huge salt pan. Munga Lake.
There's a lot to explore at Carrara Rangeland Park, and we'll definitely return again for a longer stay next time. We spend a few more hours exploring the area and its history before hitting the road again following the miners' path. We make our way to Paynes Find, which has an old gold processing plant known as the Gold Battery, which is the only remaining working battery in Western Australia. Paynes Find is a small community with a local store and petrol station.
Just out of Mount Magnet, and this is meant to be a area of significant Aboriginal cultural significance, with supposedly lots of rock art. So we're going to go and have a look, see if we can find some. And here we have a old-timer classic gold digger. Looks a bit like Jules. Oh, it is Jules.
Yeah, it's me.
So we're still trying to see if we can find ourselves some rock art. And so far, we've got nothing.
After exploring every rock shelter for about 2 hours in 38 degree heat, we decide the rock art will remain a secret for the traditional owners to enjoy. We've just pulled up at Kew, and just before we've come into the town itself, there was some camels, statues and things that commemorate
the Canning Stock Route. Then we went down this road next to it and we found some old ruins, and it's the Kew Heritage Trail Old Hospital. So this is what's left.
Kew was known as the Queen of the Murchison, with a population of 10,000 in its heyday of being the centre of the Murchison Gold Rush. Its population now is approximately 170. We leave Kew and hit the dirt road once again, heading for the ghost town of Big Bell, where we set up the camp for the night. Big Bell is a ghost town located 30 kilometres southwest of the town of Kew. The town was established in 1936 and was home to the Big Bell gold mine. All that remains today is the two-story Big Bell Hotel and a church. Wandering through the ruins, you get a sense of what life might have been like in the 1930s.
Heading to Olga Rock. We've just left Big Bell, the old ghost town ship where we stayed last night. Olga Rock has points of interest of some good indigenous arts, and certainly a rock that the custodians are happy for you to climb. So we'll certainly spend a little bit of time having a look around. So as you do, we'll go to the gate and then we'll drive off. See ya!
Made it to the top. It's just a magnificent view up here. You can see that behind me. It's not that high, to be honest. It's not that hard to walk up. It's just gorgeous, and there's another one, I think it's Afghan, in the distance over there.
We're walking up to a beautiful spot here at Lake Nalan, which is a 48-hour highway stop. So it's on the Great Northern Highway, probably about 100 k's from south of Meekatharra. And yeah, found this beautiful looking lake and full of water and bird life, and really quite a bit of an oasis from the travelling that we've been doing this week.
It's a short drive into Meekatharra via the Great Northern Highway before we turn off and head down the unsealed road to Sandstone.
Climbing up Yarrawong Hill. It's about 500 meters high apparently. Doesn't feel like it, but no one around. We're on our way to Sandstone from Meekatharra, and it's just as outback and remote as you can get. There really isn't a soul around. The view is sensational, and we'll continue climbing and see how far we can get up. So that's the path to the peak, possibly.
I think there might be gold in this one.
Okay, Livingston, let's keep going. I'm not far off getting to the top of this hill, and starting to puff a bit, but hopefully worth the climb. The views already are quite spectacular. Top. There's still a little mound there, right as a peak that I haven't climbed. It looks like it's a very slight incline to traverse, but right now I'm puffing, and that's probably enough. Whew! 6 o'clock and it's bloody freezing. First thing to do is get the fire going this morning. It's very cold. Jules is just taking a couple extra Z's in the camper. Kettle's boiling, and we're camped next to, I think, I'm not sure the pronunciation's right, Belangi Rock, which is just there. So when the sun rises, it'll light that rock up for some incredible views from the camp. Outback bush camping doesn't get any better.
After breakfast, we climbed the rock and explored around its regions, and then continued the drive into Sandstone. Trail just outside of Sandstone, and we've come to have a look at the old brewery. We've been to see London Bridge, and the old brewery was established in 1907 by an Irishman, Mr. Kearney. Anyway, he established this brewery up here, up the top. He has a water hole that comes down into the cave. This
surely it couldn't have been chiseled. It must have been blasted to make this. And then up here, that's where the water came down to help make the brew. And he was smart. He knew it would get vandalized. So he had definitely put some nice big naughty doors on it, which you can still see the markings of. But it's very cool in there. So on even hot days, the brew would stay nice and cool.
We spent another night bush camping before heading to the coast. We had 5 nights following the miner's path and in total awe of the experiences we discovered. We hope you have enjoyed a taste of the golden outback.